Okay, we're going to call to order the February 22nd meeting of the Highland Park Board of Education. The New Jersey Open Public Meeting Act was enacted to ensure the right of the public to have advance notice of and to attend the meetings of the public bodies at which any business affecting their interest is discussed or acted upon. In compliance with the Open Public Meeting Act, the Highland Park Board of Education has caused notice of this meeting, setting forth the time, date, and location to be submitted for publication to the Home News Tribune and Star Ledger and posted on the board's website at least 48 hours in advance of this meeting. Members of the public who wish to address the board will be given the opportunity to do so before the board adjourns for the evening. Linda, can we get a roll call?
Ms. Beyer?
Here.
Ms. Simarusti?
Here.
Ms. Gowan? Mr. Krieger?
Here.
Mr. Magaziner?
Here.
Ms. McFadden DiNicola?
Here.
Ms. Piacerbono?
Here.
Ms. Richardson?
Here.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Here.
Okay, and be it resolved, pursuant to the Sunshine Act, NJSA 10-4-12 and 13, the Highland Park Board of Education will now meet in closed session to discuss potential litigation related to charter schools and special education and other confidential matters related to discipline of personnel, negotiations, and litigation. These exemptions are permitted to be discussed in closed session in accordance with NJSA 10-4-13. Information regarding the board's closed session discussion will be closed to the public as soon as, or will be disclosed to the public as soon as the need for confidentiality no longer exists. Can I get a motion to go into closed session?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
And roll call, Linda? Do we need a roll call?
Yes. Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Simarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden DiNicola?
Yes.
Ms. Piacerbono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
To reconvene to public session?
So moved.
Can I get a second?
Second.
Linda?
Give her a second. Give her a second. Yeah, give me a second.
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Simarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden DiNicola?
Yes.
Ms. Piacerbono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
All right, can we all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, Linda, we have two communications on the agenda, and I have to say I'm very excited for the first time. I think this might be the first time we have only two things on the agenda, and they're both compliments. Those are two really lovely words to see on the communications. Are there any other communications other than these two?
Yes, we received an email today. If I can get to it, sorry.
Yes, we did.
Which everyone should have received from Ms. Kim Hammond. I'm assuming you all read it.
Yes.
And I believe that, you were going to do something on the public comment. I believe that's all.
Okay, thank you very much, Linda. And then we're going to move the minutes from the regular and executive sessions on January 19th, 2016, and the regular public workshop and executive sessions on February 1st, 2006. Is there any discussion? Oh, I'm sorry, can we have a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? No? Okay, seeing none, Linda, can we have a roll call?
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Simarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden DiNicola?
Yes.
Ms. Piacerbono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
Okay, and with that, we're going to move to the superintendent's report.
So it's my pleasure to reintroduce, as I do at least once a month, our student representatives who will be giving their report.
Thank you. All right, so we have a bit of a longer report this week, but so from Irving, they had a National Wear Red Day and Sports Day, and they also started a weather station for kids in pre-K. Bartle School on February 17th celebrated their first 100 days of school. They also had the Pennies for Playtime, which goes to the Rutgers Cancer Institute, and they have Spirit Week starting this week. For the middle school, as it was suggested previously, we went and we talked to their student congress, and this is what they had to say. They are involved in organizing several fundraisers. Right now, the ones that they're doing is Toys for Tots and Pennies for Patients. And there's also a subsection in student congress called Students in Action, which is basically a group that's just focused on having community service events throughout the the middle school and helping their own community. Some of their past projects was the hygiene project, as we heard about in December. And what they do with these projects is that in April they go to Keene University and they present all the community service they did throughout the year, and they compete with about 25 other schools. And so in the high school this week, or last week on Friday, we had our first wellness day where students participated in workshops that taught them about both physical and mental wellness. There were also speakers such as Joetta Clark Diggs, who was a four times Olympian champions. And they were really, most of the students we talked to really loved the event. They said it was awesome. They really liked having speakers there, and they felt that this was something that they could see happening every year.
All right, some more exciting events from the high school. We'll try to keep it brief because everyone here is here for accomplishments from the high school, but HP DECA took first place in New Jersey for their Thrive project, which is a project on providing community service. Similarly, the Highland Park School Store is now officially recognized and certified and is one of only three other schools in New Jersey with this accomplishment. DECA will be attending state competitions from the 24th to the 26th in Cherry Hill, and students organized a Lunar New Year celebration in the high school cafeteria to celebrate and experience Chinese and Asian tradition, culture, and cuisines in the upcoming Lunar New Year. It was well attended with over 400 people attending. Senior members of the Model UN and Congress Club will be going to visit the UN on February 26th. The Model UN and Congress Club will also be hosting its own conference at the high school on May 21st. Schools from all around the state will be attending. Student Congress at the high school is also starting what we're calling the OWLS nomination. Students or teachers who display the school's mission of openness, wisdom, leadership, and or spirit will receive this nomination. On February 12th, the Red Cross Club also hosted a blood drive. Many students and teachers donated, and in the end, Highland Park donated more blood than other high schools five times our size. Boys basketball also finished their season with a win on their senior night last Tuesday. Students participating in the Global Citizenship Club went to Rutgers last Tuesday to meet with their Rutgers mentors and discuss their research. Finally, Science Bowl competed on Saturday in their first competition, making it to their seventh round. The school musical is also well underway to be performed April 13th to 15th.
Thank you. I am beaming with pride that we have so many of you here tonight. It is a testimony to the parent support we have and obviously the amazing students we have. If I could make all of my reports all about the students, I would, but I have to also get to some business. I thank the board for coming up with the idea to rotate our meetings to different locations so we can do more of this. So thank you to the Board of Education for choosing to do that. It's going to be a lot of work for Mr. Lassiter tonight because you must have at least 100 students here who you're going to be honoring. The first we would like to focus on is the one we'll spotlight this month. So Mr. Lassiter, please take the podium.
I appreciate that. As I looked in the front row and saw everyone avoiding me, I was a little worried there. Student spotlight. How do you spotlight one student when you're recognizing so many students for all their accomplishments? And so it's kind of an odd situation, but something terrible happened in our cafeteria, and then a student stepped up and addressed that without any thought to himself, without any thought to what he needed to do other than he had a friend in need and he wanted to make sure that he did something about it. And I have to really applaud our entire student body, because while this crisis was going on, and I'll explain it in a second, they remained calm. And I didn't have to worry about everyone else reacting to a situation where a student at lunch, and this could happen anywhere, took a bite of a sandwich, swallowed it the wrong way, it got stuck, and he was choking. And it was clear, as the table stood up and said, he's choking, one student stepped over and did the Heimlich, and before I could get there, the other student was not in distress anymore. So let's give a rousing round of applause to Chris Sombrano, that student who stepped up. What makes us even better is Chris is not that kind of student that stands out all the time. He's not the student that we all recognize all the time. This is a student who goes about his day, works as hard as he can. Sometimes he's not as successful as others, but this was a time where he needed all that recognition because, boy, we were all very proud of him. Just so you know, when you call it up, there will be pictures there.
Can we go in the front?
Yes.
Push back. No, no, it's fine.
Okay, now we have a bunch of recognitions that we want to do as well. And so what I'll do is I will go over each category, and we have some teacher, faculty member, and coach representatives as well that I'll call up. And when I call you up, there will be a folder right here. Just grab the folder, and then I'll turn it over to those teachers in charge of those particular areas.
Mr. Lasseter, let me interrupt. If you could also have everybody stay with you, I'd like to have a group photo.
Yes. And so remember, as I go through each category, just stand off to the side after you get to your award, and then we're going to take a group shot. Okay? So the first category is random. Okay, these are random awards. And before I go into this, I just want everyone to know, we really try to recognize students all the time at the high school. We have Student of the Month breakfast. We have a Student of the Year dinner. The Student Congress helped me to start the Golden Owl Awards for all our students who show openness, leadership, and spirit, along with wisdom, sorry. And that goes to our faculty members as well. So we really try to recognize achievement in our building. So the first award was one that a student did on his own outside of school. And this was at the 2015 International Student Summit on Global Counterterrorism. Pretty heavy duty stuff here, but we did have a student recognized as the outstanding regional group. This young man took on representing the Middle East on global counterterrorism. So please give a round of applause for Adam LaBelle McLean. Not an easy feat to represent the entire Middle East on global counterterrorism. This student distinguished herself at the 36th annual GSSAA. This was a writing day at Rutgers. And just on the spot writing, this young lady, Amita Shukla, took third place. So congratulations, Amita. And a hearty congratulations goes out to this student for the United States Presidential Scholars Program. Very distinguished accomplishment for this young man to be recognized as a presidential scholar. Congratulations to Michael Wayne. Okay, I'm going to announce this group of students together, okay? These are our two Central Jersey Region Mixed and Treble Honor Choir members, Keith O'Donnell and Yulin Nee. Great job. And we won't put them on the spot and make them sing us a song. Okay, these next two students are distinguished for their singing as well, but they are recognized by the New Jersey All-State Treble Choir, Central Jersey Region Mixed and Treble Honor Choirs as well. So please give a round of applause to Jamie Ashenow and Michelle Fahn. And not to be left unrecognized, our orchestra program has a regional finalist as well who participated in the region orchestra. And so please give a round of applause to Yujong Choi, please. And so I received a letter in the mail from Prudential Spirit of the Community. This is an organization that recognizes volunteer service in our community. And so we have one student who has a special certificate actually signed by President Obama. And so please give a rousing round of applause to our volunteer at the President's service level, Tiger Lee, please. And so these are our random students for all kinds of reasons. We can come up and take a picture of them. Guys, come on, gather around. Right here? Good. I have two students I want to recognize for their accomplishments in starting a new club, actually three, I'm sorry, starting a new club at our high school. And in fact, one of them actually, his parent emailed me recently to ask permission so he could take part in the national tournament. And this is a game called Go. I can't really explain the game, but it's complicated. Looks like a little bit like checkers and chess and a variety of things mixed together, and I probably did it a disservice in trying to explain it, but there's about 15 students now that participate regularly at lunch competing in this wonderful game. So please give a round of applause to the Go Club founder, Justin Ching, and his colleagues Larkin Shu and Andrew Z. So this time I'm going to ask Mr. Gervin to come on up and Mr. McGlynn as we turn our attention to some of our athletic prowess in the house.
I'm going to turn it right over to Coach McGlynn and he'll talk about the football awards. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming out. It's a great honor to be here with everyone receiving an award. For our team, we had 7 kids that made all division in our conference in the GMC, and 2 of them made all conference. Also, 2 boys that are here that are getting an award are also, last week were picked to play in a Snapple Bowl, which is all-star game, which is in July. That'll represent the GMC. They'll represent our school real well. They play against Union County. It is a game held at Kane University on an exact date in July. Both boys also will be going on to college to play ball. One will be at Muhlenberg. The other one hasn't decided. He could go to West Point. He could go to Rowan. Shaking his head no, but he'd be great. Or Coastal Carolina. But he has some choices to make. The first recipient of making all division was Dylan Boyton. Nasir Boykins. Noah Pointer Gamery. Ogemdi Nwadki. Ryan O'Shea. I know that, 2 of our boys couldn't be here. One had a dentist appointment this evening, Cameron Petkoff. But I would like to add that Cameron, all of our seniors, we have a few juniors and seniors here, all are going on to further education at really good institutes. I know. Cameron Petkoff was accepted to Maryland, Penn State. He will be going on to NC State to further his education. We're real proud of him. Luke Schrader is going on to Rutgers, I believe. And Kristen Dela Cruz, I think, is also going on to Rutgers. So all of our kids are moving on to further education, which as a coach, you couldn't be more proud of. So thank you very much.
Next is soccer. Unfortunately, I don't think either of our soccer coaches could make it tonight. I guess fortunately, I know these 4 athletes very well. One thing to note, all 4 of these players played on the same travel soccer team together, affectionately known as the Condor Nation. So give it up for the Condor Nation. On the boys' side, earning all division honors were Jonah Bieberman and Matt Landis. Guys, come on up. And on the girls' side, Gabriela Sanchez and Elizabeth Gervin. Next, I'll turn it over to Coach Stark and the cross-country team.
Both our boys and girls had excellent seasons this year. Our girls finished 9-1, I believe, and finished 6th in Central Jersey. Our boys finished 8-1, which was a tie for the division title, and finished 3rd in Central Jersey, advancing to states for the first time in maybe 15 years. I forget the exact dates, which was pretty cool. First couldn't be here tonight, Hannah Burke. So. Peter Tilton also made all division, and I don't think I see him here tonight. Last but not least, this student helped organize all of our summer workouts, did a great job, was a great leader for the team. If the team didn't advance, he would have advanced individually as well, Ethan Bull.
Up next, girls tennis and Coach Washington.
The girls tennis team actually won the gold division for the second year in a row, so we were champions. I don't see any of the girls here, but I will call their names. They must be getting some private tennis lessons. First, all division, Tia Wangley. Nicolette Polos. Tiffany Liang. Wenny Uyang. And Jamie Achenow.
There are two final athletic awards we would like to recognize. Two of our coaches, we have fantastic coaches in all of our sports, but two of our coaches this year received Division Coach of the Year awards. And at this point, I'll turn it over to Mr. Lassiter to introduce our coaches.
Yeah, Mr. Gervin works closest with the coaches, but at least one of them I got to teach as a student, so it's particularly an honor when you get to see them come back out and give back to the school as coaches. The other one I worked very closely with as a colleague when I taught in the middle school, and so I'm very proud of both of these members of our faculty. Mr. Tim Stark, Coach of the Year for Cross Country. And Ms. Erin Washington, Division Coach of the Year for Girls Tennis. At this point, I'm going to invite up a dynamic duo that has led one of our clubs to some incredible distinctions this year. Very proud of these two faculty members as well, because the club wouldn't be what it is without them. So please give a big round of applause to Ms. Angie Harper and Mr. Kyle Harper. Yeah, I will leave it up to them to list all the DECA awards. There are so many. It's really, really been a great year.
Oh, okay, good evening. I'm Ms. Harper. This is Mr. Harper, my son, not husband. Happened once before here. So, So anyway, we run DECA, which is an amazing club. We do a lot of the community service. We do the Make-A-Wish Walk. We do the veterans, anything that has to do with the veterans, Menlo Park. We did a new club, started the Colored Hearts this year, where three of our students, sitting right here, worked with the Bartle students, fourth graders. So we're like all over. But in January, last year we had 30 students, this year we have 70. So we doubled. So when we went to Regions in January, that's at Kane University, they have to go against hundreds of students in all different events. They're all in different events. In order to make it to the States, which we leave on Wednesday and we compete till Friday, they have to be in the top 10%, which if you figure out of 100 students, some's 200 and 300 students. We had over 32 make it. So we had half of our club advance in the top. So I'm gonna just call them all up and we'll make big waves here and give them it. And I'm gonna say what they did as they come up, okay? So first is Alyssa Pilch. Alyssa, this is her first year in DECA. She took second place in role play and first place overall in DECA at Regions. Apostoli Pistanis is not here. He is out today. But he did place in his top 10 his first year in DECA also. This is for Brent Sklarik. Brent took first place in his role play, second place in his testing, and third place overall in DECA Regions. The next one, CJ Sanchez, his first year in DECA, and he took third place in role play in DECA. Eliana Horatio, seventh place overall at DECA Regions. Esteban Cardona, second place at Regions. He's not here. Are you Esteban? Yes. Are you his mom?
Yes.
Oh, hi. How are you? Nice to meet you. Congratulations. Farhan Rezadi, he's not here, his mom. Okay. Hallie Lerner, she took ninth place in the region overall. Jack Ryan took third place in his test. Kate Ashtonoff, I know she's out sick, but she took also in the top apparel accessory, she took 10th place out of 330 other students. So. Kyle Tieringer, come on up. Kyle took sixth place overall at DECA Regions. Lillian Hunter. Lillian took third place in test and sixth place overall at Regions. Louise Liu took third place in role play and fourth place overall. And your own Mateo. Where's Juliana? Oh, there you are, dear. Okay. He took overall, sixth place overall. Max Schiffman took ninth place overall. Michelle Fan, seventh place overall. This is a really this is another freshman. First place in his test and third place overall at Regions, Noah Hartwick. Rena Michelle, first place role play, second place test, and second place overall. Sean Gao, ninth place overall. Thomas Lee took first place at Regions. He's out sick today. Wenyi Ouyang took fourth place overall. Will Chen, ninth place overall. Zorbak Badiv, he's not here. He took 10th place overall. Alana Dakowitz, she took second place in her role play and fifth place overall in marketing. Let me just make sure I have everything I need. Okay. So these are who will be leaving with us Wednesday and competing for 2 days for states. They need to place first, second, or third in state. If they do, they will go to international conference and compete against Germany, all of the United States, Guam. They have to come up first, second, or third. So we wish them a lot of luck. Okay, so I just have a few more awards, but they're already up here. So let me do these. So we have this virtual business class in the high school. And what it is it's an online game where you have to buy, sell, you open up a restaurant, and you have to compete against the whole world, okay? So two girls took first place in New Jersey this year, their first time that they ever gave it a shot. It runs for a month. And so Alana Dakowitz and Louise Liu took first place in the state of New Jersey. So now, like I said, it's a really complicated game. It's moving so fast. So there was 500 teams worldwide in it. This year, three of our students working together, what was their name? Check out my mixtape. I don't know what that, but anyway, they took first place out of 500 teams in the whole world. They are already heading to nationals in Tennessee, and this is a big feat. New Jersey has never done this. So from Little Highland Park, we have three. Eric Chen. Max Schiffman. And Thomas Lee, who is out sick. And then the last award. So we have a school store that we run. We've had it for, I guess, maybe 9-10 years. There's three schools in the state of New Jersey that has wrote a 48 report, page report. We have to go through a lot of work. This year, three of the students did just that. Highland Park did win, to get to a long story short. And now we are school-based enterprise, which means we are a certified school store, only three in the state of New Jersey. So this was a big fit task and two. And Gabrielle Gluck, Gabby. Lillian Hunter. And Alyssa Pilch. The three of them also will be going to Tennessee. They've already made it, so they're going to be going there and representing in our school store. This is our DECA program, so good luck.
We have some of our shorter, lack of better words.
Oh, wait.
I forgot something. I'm really sorry. There's two students that I have to recognize. This year, first time ever, Highland Park Color Run was ran by Eliana Horatio and Kyle Terringer. This was one of the biggest feats you could imagine. But I do want to let you know, I don't know, I'm hoping a lot of you were there because over 500 people came. We raised $8,000. Half went to their class. The other half went to Operation Shoebox. And that's where they box up and send all the stuff, all the care packages overseas. So these two, now they will be presenting that at States on Wednesday, but they deserve a big hand for that. It's a lot of work.
Before they go, I think the kids know, DECA wouldn't be DECA without the Harpers. So please give a big round of applause to Ms. Harper and Mr. Harper for all they do. Mr. and Ms. Harper have been very much behind the scenes and making sure that we have all the courses that our kids can take so they can partake in this great program. It really has made a big difference in a lot of students' lives. So I'm going to introduce the next group, but we have something that I wanted to do real quick. Model UN did something different this year. And I love DECA very much, but some of you may know that I helped to start the Model UN Club here. So in our efforts to be global citizens, the club wrote a grant last year for them to go to Montreal and to actually become an international club. So the fact that that happened, they went to Montreal, they participated in the Secondary Schools United Nations Symposium, they traveled out of country and arrived back safely. Just fantastic. They're applying again this year to see if they can go to Montreal, or hopefully we'll keep our fingers crossed, and a shout out to the HPEF, possibly Mexico City. So we look forward to that, and we want to recognize really the whole club, led by Mr. Goll and Ms. Wilson, as global ambassadors for our school. Come on up, Mr. Goll. Could those that are in the Model UN please stand? Those that are in the Model UN please stand. Those of you that went on that trip. I think we do have at least the student that helped write the grant.
So if you're unfamiliar with what Model UN is or Model Congress, it is a civic engagement program at the school where students are tasked with debating about political issues every week and think about how to solve the world's problems in a very practical way. So we had an opportunity, as was stated, to go to Montreal, and it was very much a result of Micah Gartenberg, who was involved in the writing of a grant. A lot of times the advisors step up and write grants seeking funding. In this case, we had a student that took the lead and wrote that grant and gave our school an opportunity to travel abroad for the first time in over 15 years. So it's an opportunity we hope will continue, and every student that came back from that trip was tasked with being a global ambassador in the new global citizenship program we have at the school with Rutgers University, where they have to represent themselves as global citizens in the school and will be recognized as such at graduation. So I just wanted to recognize Micah for writing that grant and for the club for taking that leap and participating in this program in Montreal. So in addition to having these weekly debates, we also attend conferences like the one we went to in Montreal, and we hope to go in Mexico.
These conferences are where the students debate for 20 hours and really get in-depth on these political issues. And we want to recognize some of the students that were given awards at the conferences. I will say it's not a very awards-driven program. All of the students that participated did an incredible job, but there were some students that were recognized with a special award. If you're here, come up. About half of them are here today. The first was Haley Conrad, who won a Best Position Paper Award. Our next student, who was mentioned before as part of the football team, is not here, Cameron Petkoff, who won Most Improved. Our next is Tiger Lee for Most Improved. Our next student is Jesse Ibarra for Most Improved. Nicholas Hay for Most Improved. Riley Carlton, Most Improved. Michelle Phan for Most Improved. Rena Michelle, Most Improved. And Samuel Leibowitz Lord, Most Improved. Micah Gartenberg, one outstanding delegate. Julia Brennan, one best delegate and outstanding delegate. She earned two awards. Jamie Achenow, one best delegate. And Noah Callahan won the Pierre Elliott Trudeau Award for Diplomatic Finesse. So again, our group has 75 students. We sent 65 to this conference. These students were recognized with a special award, and I just want to congratulate all of them for a wonderful conference and a wonderful year. We have a lot of things coming up soon. We're going to be attending a Model Congress conference, and we've been talking a lot about presidential politics lately. We'll be attending the Rutgers Model Congress in April. We're visiting the United Nations soon and mentoring some eighth grade students, and we'll be holding our very own conference in this building, inviting other schools to participate in May. And that's going to be run by alumni of the school. So that's our program. Congratulations.
Thank you, Mr. Gold and the Model UN Club. Fantastic job. I'm going to invite up Ms. Steffen now to congratulate and recognize our New Jersey Science Bowl participants. Come on up, Ms. Steffen. Give a round of applause, too.
Good evening. This weekend, the Science Bowl team participated in the 2016 New Jersey Regional Science Bowl competition in Princeton at the Physics Plasma Lab. And we've been participating in Science Bowl for the past 12 years. I would like to call all the bowlers from the A-team to come on up, please. The reason why I'm calling them all up as a team is because as I walked in tonight and I saw when they all arrived, they all sat together back there as a team. And it was a really intense competition that we had this past Saturday. I have never experienced such thrill of being in a competition ever. And one of the main reasons for it, the highlight of my weekend, was they went up against Princeton High School, and the final score was 104 to 102, and it was Highland Park High School that won, and it was a nail-biting experience. And I was like, so, unfortunately, however, we did not take home a trophy, but I'm very, very proud of these gentlemen for participating. We went as far as the seventh round, and I would like to introduce our captain, Mr. Patrick Liu. This is Patrick's senior year. He'll be leaving us. However, he's been a bowler since middle school. And when I say a bowler, there's a middle school science bowl team run by Miss Anand. And she says that team is growing, so I expect a lot of middle schoolers here next year. And it's bittersweet to see Patrick leaving us this year because it's his senior year. And the other members of the team have also been with us since middle school. And we also have a sophomore on the team. Sophomore, Mr. Kevin Marks, and he will be our captain for next year. So, I do have their certificate of participation given to them by the Physics Plasma Lab in Princeton for participation in the Science Bowl competition. And the first one goes to Mr. Michael Wang, senior, leaving. We have Mr. William John, another senior. Nicholas Hay. And Patrick Liu, our senior. Patrick has been the captain of the team for the past 2 years. And I left this last certificate to give to Mr. Kevin Marks, our incoming senior, captain, sophomore. I have him for 2 more years. The A team got a chance to participate. However, when we meet as the Science Bowl teams, there are 3 teams. And unfortunately, because the competition is so intense and we have had 32 schools in the competition, the A team were the only team that got a chance to participate. The B team and the C team did not get a chance to participate, but some of those members are here tonight. And I did see them get awards and accolades from DECA. They may have already left. If you're here, could you please stand so we can give you a round of applause for participating in bowl this year? And the only person who's still here is Noah. I see Noah standing and Eric is still standing. Noah and Eric were freshmen. They started off as middle school bowlers, and now they're here with us this year. And looking forward to intense nail batting competitions next year with the bowlers. Hold on a minute. We don't actually bowl. Patrick, can you explain science bowl? What do we actually do?
So there's
can you use the mic?
So the game is there's 2 teams, each with 4 active members at a time, and we each have buzzers. And the moderators read us questions, and we buzz in if we know the answers and try to give the right answers. And you get the categories are chemistry, physics, biology, math, and energy, because it takes place at the Plasma Physics Lab, which is a Department of Energy facility.
Thanks, Jeremy.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Steffen and the Science Bowl team. Those of you that are heading on out, we do have one more category. We'll be done in a second. I'm not even sure these students are here, but I do want to recognize them. And then we do have some refreshments as we take a brief break, some cookies and some drinks before you leave. So there's one more group of students. These are band students who represent a jazz trio. Mr. Coleman could not be here tonight to honor these students. But he took them to Boston. And in Boston, at the Berklee College of Music High School Jazz Festival, these three students won third place out of all the teams that were there. So it was an incredible accomplishment. They also will receive a 25% scholarship to attend Berklee's summer program this summer. So congratulations to Josh Siegel, Jem Seidel, and Luke Schrader, if you're here. Without further ado, I'm going to hand it back to Dr. Taylor, and we'll go on with the rest of this meeting. But I do know that we have refreshments, so Dr. Taylor, I don't know if you want to take a little break first.
Yeah, we are. So we've got two more items on my personal superintendent presentation agenda. One, I would encourage you to stay for is a presentation that members of our child study team, some of our special education teachers will make about a very, very exciting program that is in the works and is going to expand next year, which I would love for you to see and hear. And then you can all leave if you'd like, because then I get to my business portion of the presentation. I will be talking about the state of curriculum development in the district. I'll be talking about PARC. And then I'm going to wrap it up by talking a little bit about all the community outreach we're doing. But before that, in the next 5 minutes, take some time to have a cookie, bottle of water, mill about, and then at about five, I'll regroup, okay? Back up with my presentation. I'll give everybody about 30 seconds to regroup.
She's out, but you can save her one.
The cookies are gone.
Yeah.
And being that every high school student's usual bedtime's about like 9 o'clock,
oh, yeah.
I'm a high schooler. I know what time the bedtime is. It's whenever the iPhone goes off. It's whenever the iPad shuts down. So it is an honor and a pleasure to introduce somebody who is very special to the district, who's going to introduce other very special people who are going to be talking about something that is very exciting. The board will probably be introduced to this program for the first time, but be on the lookout because this program is going to become a very intricate part of not only what we do in the area of special education, but I think you're going to see it's going to have effects on how we operate our general education program as well. So without further ado, I would like to introduce the social worker at the middle and high school, Dee Dee Deacher, who is going to introduce some other folks.
Good evening. I would like to welcome my amazing team that's here with me. We have Ashley Allshouse, who's our school psychologist on the middle school, high school. Esther Torsky, our speech and language therapist. And the real reason that all our programs happen are the teachers. So we have June Miller, our high school teacher, Margaret Claslow, our middle school teacher, and we're very honored to have one of our paraprofessionals, Josie Rosario, here with us also. Several years ago in the middle school, it was actually under Michael Lasseter, we realized that we needed to create a program for children that needed to learn a little differently. Kids that were not your typical pencil paper learner and who needed more actual experiences in order to take in all the experiences in the world. And we started at that point a self-contained program with life skills involved in it. And we're excited beyond belief to say that we have a name now to our program. In the high school, it's called GLOW. In the middle school, it's called GLOW Junior, and it's a really progressional program for the middle school, high school. GLOW stands for Growth and Learning Outside Walls, because that's really what we're doing. We're taking our learning outside walls. We have a wonderful presentation that I think will speak more than I can. So with all ado, and I give Esther Torsky full credit, because she put this entire film together.
program for students to learn to live a productive and independent life. Rather than learn reading and math skills in isolation, the skills are infused into real-life activities. For example, students learn reading and math skills by reading a recipe, determining the ingredients they need to make this recipe, going to the grocery store, pricing the items, and purchasing them. Then, we go back to the school and use the foods kitchen to actually make the recipe. In addition, the students do as many school-related jobs as possible, such as putting mail in the mailboxes and serving students in the cafeteria. The students in the GLOW program have proven themselves to be a true asset to both the school and the community.
My name is Victor. I like to work in the cafeteria. I like to serve lunch for the middle school kids. Sometimes I give out the snacks.
I would give a 2 thumbs up to the program, and Victor loves, enjoys, and takes very seriously the program. And I would like just to see the program continue in the future. I just cannot express myself how much I appreciate everybody who worked with my son and with all peers that Victor has in a self-contained class. So.
My name is Mark Anthony. I like working at Irving School. I like reading stories to the little kids.
Our CBI program here at Highland Park High School is, in all honesty, one of the most fantastic programs we have to offer our students. It keeps many of our most delicate, our students with the greatest need in our school and in our community, which they need to be. They interact with the other students in the building, they interact with the faculty, and the confidence that I see each one of them gain daily. So this program, instrumental, and all I can hope for is that we can expand it as we go into the future.
The goal of the GLOW Junior program in Highland Park Middle School is to enable students with significant cognitive and developmental delays to acquire and generalize life skills which are necessary to become independent, functioning members of our society. The 6th, 7th, and 8th grade students operate the Owlet, which is our school store. The other big program in middle school is the Coffee Spot. We also have some pet fish. We infuse educational services into our everyday curriculum with the speech therapist, the physical therapist, and the occupational therapist. So in GLOW Junior, we're really preparing the kids so that they are ready to move right into the GLOW program in high school.
My name is Ma'am. I like to do jobs. My favorite job is the cash register for the school store.
My name is Jason.
My name is Devin. I like to do jobs. My favorite job is the mailman. We put the mail in the mailboxes.
The GLOW Junior program is so inspirational because I have seen students grow academically and socially. They've become a part of the fabric of our middle school, but just in every thread. And I am so, so proud of these students.
Thank you. How much money do you
owe? Miss Grasslow, teachers over here, they're working so hard for him so he can make a better day. And they're doing amazing. I'm so glad and thankful, and God bless all of them.
It has been wonderful over the last 4 years to see how our GLOW program has really grown and expanded. We've taken our learning outside of our school walls, whether it be in our school-based jobs, outside in the community, or on our job sites. The success of our program is due to the wonderful support we get from our administration, our staff members, our parent body, and the Highland Park community at large. We thank you so much, and we can't wait for you to continue to see us grow and glow.
Go GLOW!
Go GLOW!
Any other words you want to say, Ms. Teacher, or does that say it enough? If any members of the board have questions, we have, not only do we have teachers, members of the child study team, we also have a parent, who I'm not going to put on the spot, but I'm very honored that the parent came out and one of the students in our program. I'm sorry? Oh, yes, too. Thank you. There you are, Frankie's mom. And thank you back there. We got to sit together. And I also must add that we have the honor of having Susie Boudin, who is our new Director of Educational Services here. She came out to support the program, but you should also know that Susie has a tremendous amount of experience working in the CBI arena, so I think this is the planets are aligned for this program. So with that, are there any questions from the board? If not, you have pamphlets and you can always reach out to the teachers.
Yeah. I just want to mention the pamphlet is really our next step. What we have to do now is we need to go out into the community and help find placements for our children. So any support, guidance anybody would like to offer, at this point we're really looking to go out and to sell our program into the Highland Park town so we can help our children have more experiences. So that's what the pamphlet you got is. That will be going out to retail shops along with a copy of the movie you just saw.
Any questions?
I had a quick question. The video, is that going to be available on the website?
Will the video be available on the website? Well, we do have permission from the kids' families, obviously, to share the video. It's a good question. We should talk about that. Is that an idea you have? Okay. You know, one of the reasons why they put together the video and the packets is so they could market the program to potential community hosts. So I guess it would help to have a central place for everybody to go. Anyone else? Thank you for coming out and supporting the program and showing it to us. And parents, thank you. And Susie, thanks for being here too. Appreciate it. Now please, if anybody is lingering, this is your time to leave. If you don't think you'll be staying for the remainder of the meeting, this is your out. So Mr. Lasseter, you've had a long day. Members of the board, today is the first day of our four-day visit by the Middle States Accreditation visiting team. They are staying at the Heldrich. They come from different schools from around the state. They have different positions in those schools, and so Mr. Lasseter has been hosting them, and will continue to host them in the next couple of days. So with that, I want to provide as brief a goals update as I can so we could move on to the rest of the agenda. This is the goal I've been strictly focusing on when it comes to trying to enhance student achievement in the last couple of months. I've talked about my work in the area of curriculum development. One of the things I mentioned at my last presentation was that a series of curriculum committee meetings have been leading us to develop a five-year curriculum revision cycle. And we are now prepared to introduce what will be the first year of this cycle. As you can see, what the curriculum committee teams of teachers and I have decided is that before the end of the year, we are going to set out to redevelop our middle school math program, our K-12 science program. And I did already mention that that was a content area that we had on our radar because we have to align the science curriculum to the next generation science standards. And we're going to take a very good look at our health K-12 curriculum. In my last Honeywell message, I pointed out that this is an area we really need to take a look at soon because one of the components of health education, family life education, sex education, as it was referred to back in the day, is missing at the lower grade level. Or if it's happening, it's not happening consistently. And that's a very tricky thing for both families, students, and students, as well as faculty to confront if we're not all on the same page. So these are the content areas we're going to be looking at this year. You can see that we will also be looking at our language arts K-12 program, anticipating it will move into step two, which is the design phase, next year. So that means if you're trying to figure out the long-range plan, the language arts K-12 curriculum that we redesigned in 2016-17 will be implemented, ready to go 2017-2018, if I'm getting my years right. So I'm going to be fleshing out the five-year plan so you can see exactly where every content area will be on the guide. Another goal that I haven't meant to really focus on, but it's just been a byproduct of the way I lead, has to do with strengthening communication and outreach. This is a goal I inherited. All the district goals are goals I inherited. We, as a district, are now bringing in the community around at least these five committees, if not other arenas, like Mr. Lassiter and his building-based parent committee, or Mrs. Osemiye and some of the committees she's developed to try to focus, try to plan a Latino night, which is coming up on Sunday night, as a matter of fact. I just want to touch on what each of these committees has been doing, and then I'm going to move on. So there are two advisory committees with which I meet on a quarterly basis. We'll meet 3 to 4 times a year. These groups of parents, a total of 31 parents, who are split, I've got 20 on in one group and 11 in the other, have been helping me identify immediate needs. Short term, these are the things we have to look at now. For instance, one of the groups has been targeting safety, traffic safety in particular, as an immediate need we need to address. We're as a group going to be developing an action plan to try to enhance traffic safety. One of the things that might come out of it, for instance, is the high school drop-off in the morning, and the problem with, I forgot the name of the street, but it's the street I know I dropped my daughter off when I'm heading straight and the high school is to the left. It starts with an M, I should know, because I've been living in this town for 22 years. Could be. I'm sorry, I have to go out there and look at it. Nevertheless, we might be asking the police department if they'd reroute the turns so that there'll be no left turn onto North 4th, which tends to be a real trouble spot in front of the library, and perhaps just in the morning have a right turn only direction. So these are the things, the kinds of short-term problems and then solutions these committees are going to be addressing. They're my go-to folks. If I have concerns, if I need a sounding board, I'll reach out to these 31 parents who volunteered to be on the committee. I didn't handpick them. When I put the call out, they came calling. So those are the two superintendent community advisory committees. I'll come back to the ad hoc committees in a second. We do have a steering committee of 11 individuals with whom I'll be meeting this Wednesday night, to help our district begin charting what will be the development of our strategic plan that I anticipate will frame the next 5 years of goals and action plans. The strategic planning process is, if it's done right, can be not only a very complex affair, but it could be an extremely effective way to align everything that the district must do, from budgeting for funds, to support programs, to teacher evaluation, to setting goals for the superintendent. All of that will hopefully come together if we do this right, this strategic plan process right. But I do need a small group, a steering committee, to help me chart the organization of that plan. So that group is meeting on Wednesday night. It's made up of 11 people, including folks like Bruce Morgan, who will be representing the NAACP. He's the president of the NAACP chapter in New Brunswick. We have a member of the Orthodox community who doesn't have children in our schools but serves on several boards and local Orthodox synagogues. And then parents, a couple of principals, myself, and a teacher from every school. So there'll be one teacher from each school on this committee as well. The District Safety Committee has met 3 times. That group is comprised of, I believe, 14 people, one board member, Ann Gowan, our school liaison officer, Officer Cabello, Seth Capperdale, local minister. We have a school nurse on that committee. Again, teachers and members of the leadership team. And I should also add Jim Paulos, who's the Highland Park OEM director, and of course is responsible for safety and security at the county level in his role as a freeholder. We've been tackling some core issues, two of which I'll hopefully report out we have solved at the next board meeting. One has to do with how we are working with visitors from outside who come to our school and identify those visitors. And the other is how we are working with parent chaperones who might attend overnight trips or even day trips. So we're coming very close to coming to consensus on very reasonable and effective ways to tackle those issues. And I hope at the next meeting I'll be able to report out to the board on the results. And finally, we do have two ad hoc committees. These committees are pop-up committees that are in existence to address specific issues. One, on how we are disciplining students from different subgroups, white, black, Hispanic, special education, general education, Asian. And that group is also taking a look at the way we are working with students who we discipline. One of the things that came out of the meeting that Mrs. Richardson sat on, we have four members of HP, parents of students of color, or three?
Three.
Three, thank you. And Mrs. Asamoah from the Teen Center, Mr. Lassiter, Mrs. Osemier, the middle school principal, and myself on that committee. For now, it might expand if we feel it's necessary. We began looking at data that I have shared with members of that committee that show how we have been working with students we discipline, the frequency of discipline issues with students in certain subgroups. We have found data that supports the civil rights data that was shared by Justin Burton, who is a member of the community, who spoke in front of the board twice about it. That's data from 2011. What came out of our discussion was also a very healthy, robust, I should say, talk about how we need to promote more restorative practices. What in some schools is referred to as restorative justice practices, to work with the kids who are repeatedly suspended out of school, suspended in school. The board receives a discipline report in executive session, because it's confidential information, about the number of infractions that we've had to address in the schools. And even tonight we saw that we have certain students who are repeatedly repeat offenders. And to me, that's as much a problem that we have to correct on our own as it is an issue that the student has to correct in terms of his or her behavior. And at some point, I believe Ms. Richardson is going to be talking more to the board about our work in that committee, because she is the liaison to the committee. And finally, we have a committee that has also met three times so far, scheduled a fourth meeting in the next month, that is crafting what is probably going to be, what I've been told by Stephanie Sazzo, who is a resident, soon to be parent in our district, and is an expert, is a psychologist and an expert in working with families who are helping children as they transition, is saying maybe one of the most thoughtful and progressive, at least in our region, if not in the state. What we are doing is we are taking a starting policy that we took from Princeton. I believe Darcy shared that with us, which we thought was a good start. And then we are grabbing resources from national advocacy groups and working with Stephanie around the table and a parent in our community, as well as Michelle McFadden DiNicola, who is representing the board and parents as well. And we have at each of our meetings been building on the Princeton policy, so it fits our needs as a community in Highland Park. And I believe our work is actually done in its first draft in terms of the policy. Right now, what we're doing is looking at supporting documents that we can also share with the board. So I believe we'll be able to give the board, if not in March, at the latest in April, the policy for first read, which means we could have it presented back to the board for second read in May, and we'll be able to implement it in June. It'll be obviously more timely for September start. Before I move into the last phase of my presentation, are there any questions about anything I've shared so far? It's a lot. Comments? Okay.
I think I have
Michelle.
One question. The positive behavior support in schools program, was that discussed at the discipline equity committee? The program that was suggested, I can't remember how many. I think it was Justin who suggested it, and also Ann brought it up. It was positive behavior support in schools. It was a free of charge training that was available. They would come in from, I believe it was Rutgers University, was offering the program.
I know that we had received resources about that program.
Right.
That hasn't come up yet in the ad hoc committee on discipline equity. I mean, what I do foresee happening, I should add, so the work that's being done by at least that one ad hoc committee, and we discuss this as a committee, will have to find a way to be woven into the strategic plan, or else the concern I have is that it won't be memorialized, won't be codified, won't be institutionalized. If we're going to live by the strategic plan, we need to take resources like you mentioned and find a way to introduce them not only in that committee, but then in the planning process as for consideration. Because there are a lot of ideas out there. I mentioned to the board in closed session about my work in the area of social emotional learning. There's such things called peace circles. I can go on. I mean, there are all kinds of resources. So we've got to look at the whole menu that's out there.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I was just wondering because this had come up twice before in meetings, so I was just kind of checking up, seeing if that had been discussed in the committee.
Not yet.
Okay. Thank you.
So the last phase of my presentation is my promise to come back to Park. So when I last spoke about Park, I presented the performance data that the district received. And I placed that presentation on the web, so I'm not going to go over that information again. But you could download my presentation. You'll see a comparison of Highland Park's performance against the state and against all the other states, and there are not many of them left that administered the park. And we did fairly well. I ended the presentation. I also talked about participation rates. I pointed out that our average appears to be around 14.5% of the students in Highland Park who did not participate in the park. So things have changed a little since my last presentation. I received a report from the State Department of Education. All districts in the state received this report that shows targets that have been established just for participation rates. This is all new. I have never, none of my colleagues and I have seen such a thing for a separate target report for the NJASCA, for the HESPA. It does seem to be that for Park, the state is particularly singling out participation rates for emphasis. Participation rates have always been a factor in school performance work ratings. But this is the first time I can recall getting a whole separate file or document on participation rates. I got it. And what we have found is that Highland Park has not met its target for participation in the park. So what that means is I'll be working on a corrective action plan to show the state that, look, you know, we have our feelings about the park, but we're going to make a good faith effort to get the word out about what Park is. And if parents decide that they're going to go ahead and let their students take the park, so be it. If not, you know, we have to value and respect the way parents want to raise their kids. So I'm just touching base with the board on the corrective action plan because I will come to the board next month. I'll probably start with the workshop meeting so we can have a discussion about the plan. And I'll ask for your approval of the plan at the second March meeting so I can send it to the state. The state is requiring me to fill out this this template by the end of March. So that is my presentation. Are there any questions about what I just shared with you regarding the park? Comments?
I just wanted to add a little bit to that last piece, just a tiny bit of perspective. I don't know how many districts overall are being put into this position of having to do a corrective action plan. Scott, I think you had said that there were at least about 150 districts overall that didn't meet participation goals. So that puts us in with a quarter of the state. So I just want people to be reassured that Highland Park isn't being singled out, or we're, you know, one of very few districts that didn't meet participation rates. We're one of a quarter of the districts in the state. But in addition, I believe that the state is actually, any district that has even one school that didn't meet participation rates, they'll have to do corrective action plans for those schools.
Correct.
So I'd be fascinated to know how many districts overall are having to do corrective action plans because just an individual school or two schools didn't meet participation rates. So, you know, this is going on across the state. It's generating a lot of controversy in terms of the Department of Education's decision to put out reports like this, to require this of districts, because this is really just pushing around a lot of paper. And something that Scott and I have talked about a lot is, you know, my feelings on this, you know, both personally and as a board member, are the district administers the tests. Parents' responses to those tests are parents' responses. That the district should be held accountable for the percentage of students whose parents do not refuse them. If we have 15% of the parents in our district decide not to allow their students to take the test, then I think what the district should be held accountable for is the parents who do allow their students to take the test. To ask districts to intervene and basically strong-arm parents who've made decisions for whatever their reasons are, into taking the test using all sorts of tactics of threats of funding and other things, I can't get behind. So I just kind of wanted to put a little bit more perspective on that. You know, this is something that's not just happening in New Jersey, it's happening across the country. And my own personal opinion is that tactics like these actually, if anything, they actually will increase, they tend to increase the refusal rates, not decrease them, because it feels very much like, you know, making administrators spin the wheels for no terribly good reason. And that's, you know, that's time you could be spending on our curriculum, that's time you could be spending on all kinds of things that will actually benefit our students, so. Also, I see that your hand's in the back, but we can't interact until public comment. So if you want to wait until public comment, you could come on up then.
And the corrective action plan, that's related to participation below 95%. And do we have an anticipated participation rate for this year?
No, I have no idea. We set a soft deadline for March 12th or 11th to have our parents tell us if they're going to opt their students out. And I haven't checked the spreadsheet. We have a live spreadsheet we use.
I have also a question.
I can report those numbers out, though, next time.
I just wanted to know if, in addition to receiving the request from the state, if the state had made a request of districts to allow parents more information about their rights, whether or not the test is something they would like their children to take, if the information given to parents is to inform parents of their rights and what the test is testing. So, because I think that a lot of the information that has gotten out to parents thus far has been kind of in these, you know, word of mouth ways and through organizations like Save Our Schools New Jersey and, you know, United Opt Out. But it looks to me like the state is not giving us all the information that we would like to have as parents. So I just wondered if, in addition to the corrective action plan that they're asking you to, you know, kind of remediate, are they also promoting more information for parents?
I'll be very frank with you, because as Darcy pointed out, I'm trying to focus more on curriculum and whatnot. I haven't looked at the corrective action plan template yet. I just know it's there. However, you've raised a good point. I think no matter what the correction action plan tells me to do or not, the district ought to provide another information night and we've tentatively scheduled something for early March. I'll provide more details as soon as I can. That goes into all that.
Wonderful.
Including, if FYI, to parents in the audience, how the school day schedule has been set up for the test, what will happen to students during the day who decide not to, whose families choose to opt them out, what will their day look like? So we'll go over all that in the information session. I could speak to that, what your points as well. Yeah.
So the state is requiring this corrective action plan, and what is there a penalty if we do not?
That's the $20,000 question. I have not heard anything about that, and what I can say is legislatures have already passed a bill that indicates funding cannot be withheld as a result of low participation rates. So I'm thinking that that's one thing that will not come our way. Foreseeables, look, right now the middle school is a focus school. We have the Regional Assistance Center, which is an arm of the Department of Ed, an assistance arm, in our middle school a lot. And they've provided us some good ideas and whatnot, but I have concerns about the time it takes away from the stuff that we have to do. And we could see something like that along the lines of the participation rates. I don't know how they would go about setting up a weekly visit to encourage me to participate, have parents participate in the test. I mean, let's be honest, even if I was to vociferously encourage parents to come out and make sure their kids take the test, I'm not going to change hearts and minds of folks who've made up their mind. I've made up my mind as a parent, I'll tell you that, as a superintendent, as a parent. So it's a tricky situation, so which is why even though I think that's a potential, I don't think it's a likely potential for it to be as intrusive as it has been right now.
But there are changes that are in the time frame of the test this year, like it's a shorter duration, and so there's less impact on the
Yeah, there is, and that's one thing we'll talk about at the information night.
Okay.
So I commend Mr. Lassiter. He has been spending a lot of time working on a schedule that would allow us to not disrupt the school day for students who don't take the test this year, because it's only a month window instead of 2 months, and less time is being taken away from classes for the test. So in the end, this round of administration might have less of a negative impact on instruction in general, and especially for the students who don't take the test.
Yeah, but as long as we can get like all those components that they're changing in the testing for this year, you know, out to those parents at that information meeting, you know, because some of those might be components that would change their point of view on the test.
Yeah, so that's a great point, Rob, and that's why we're going to have this information session at least a week, maybe a little more than a week before the deadline, to have parents tell us if they would like to opt their students out. So they have a week to make a decision after that information session. If that's it, I'm going to pass the mic back to the president.
First, I'll turn my microphone on. And we'll move to the board committee reports and recommendations. Now, this is the first time that we're doing this as with voting session. At our last workshop session, we went through a lot of these items already and had discussion about them. I think probably for each of the committees, there are a few items that were added for various reasons, whether new things just came up or we had a bit of an anomaly with the last agenda because the person who usually does the agendas was out for a couple of weeks, so the person who was doing the agendas that doesn't usually do the agendas, you know, it was a little bit tricky to get everything, you know, make sure everything was on there. So I'll just ask the committee chairs to kind of run through the stuff that we've already gone through and highlight anything that's new, and then we'll see if there's any discussion in any other particular reports. So for curriculum and instruction, Michelle.
Okay. So we discussed last time the two supervisor positions. For humanities, director of curriculum instruction of humanities.
What number is that on the agenda? Do you have a number?
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. Just so I can orient myself.
You know what? Okay. Okay, this is, the new format is a little bit confusing. I was bringing up an item that we had discussed.
Oh, no, no, no. Right now we're just going through agenda items.
Okay. So,
sorry.
Scratch that, sorry. Whoops. Let's see. The planning guide. Right, so the planning guide was item number one. I think, yeah, Mr. Lesser spoke about that at the last meeting.
Yep.
And the changes to grading, I don't know if that was included in here, so.
No.
That was part of his presentation, I remember, but that was not part of this item. Item number two is approval of field trip requests. Item number three, appointment of university graduate students for teaching internships, junior practicum, observation. Should I just read through them?
You don't have to go through all of them. I mean, just if there's anything in particular that you want to highlight. Because most of it we did go over, most of it we covered at the last meeting.
Yeah,
at the last
that's what I'm
meeting.
Seeing here. I'm not really sure if there's anything new.
Yep. Yeah, and that's kind of how these, I mean, this, for anybody who's watching or anybody's here, this is kind of the first time that we're doing this format. So, you know, we'll kind of work the kinks out of it as we go. But the idea is that we have most of the discussion happens at the workshop session. And then by the time we get to the voting session, it's pretty much we're voting on the item. So there's not going to be as much discussion as there is at the workshop. The idea is that the discussion happens there. It gives the public more opportunity for input. It gives the public the opportunity in between the workshop and the voting session to have input before the board votes, and just kind of opens up the process a bit. So yeah, I mean, so Michelle, you can just kind of, you know, if there isn't anything in particular new or that you feel we need to highlight, we can move on. We can ask if there's any questions about any items, and if not, we'll move on to the next one.
Yeah, I think we should go ahead with questions.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions about any curriculum items?
I just have one, which was item number one with the school planning guide. I had asked at the session last time whether there were plans to put this online to make it more accessible to families. I tried to find it online and I can't find anything on the high school's website. It's an anomaly. Other schools have their full planning guides, curriculum, everything is laid out on their websites so that it's easy to look at and see.
Right.
These are the courses available at the school. This is how you progress through them.
Mm-hmm.
And families can sit down and then look at all those courses and make decisions about, okay, so this is where you want to go to. How do you get there? I never got an answer on whether or not we were putting it online and whether that was something we could do.
I expect it to go online. I don't know any other way. So we'll wait until you presumably approve the plan tonight and then we can put it online. Yeah, I suspect it'll go on the, there's a high school quick links area. Mm-hmm. And go there.
Okay.
That actually raises another question that I just remember from, I don't know how many months ago, that a parent had come up to the podium and asked about steps in which to gain access to different courses. For instance, in maths, there are courses that are prerequisites to obtain access to other courses. And so especially in the middle school, she was talking about that it was a difficulty to understand which courses you needed to take in order to get to that level by the time you got into high school. Is that included in the planning guide? I'm not really sure.
I had that on my to-do list, and then I nixed it because I recognized that things might change after the strategic plan.
Oh.
So rather than put all that information up there, I thought it'd be best to go clean slate in the fall.
Okay. So I guess we'll
so
just
if that's
that.
Acceptable, that's what I'd like to do.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it would be a goal for us to make in the future. So maybe if we could just keep that in mind when we do our strategic plan, that would be good.
Oh, yeah, sure.
But I know that Cherise, many, many other districts, if you look at their website, they not only have the planning guide, but they have a list of courses. So you can see in one page, you know, what languages are available, et cetera.
And right. Well, and then it's also a question of understanding the progression through them from the middle school through the high school so that you understand if you're in math 7 this year, your classes you're eligible for next year are X. And then from there into freshman year,
right,
what are you eligible for at the high school level? Because it really, you know, it makes a huge difference in terms of the potential outcomes long term. We've got to get people to start thinking more about their education as a holistic thing that builds on itself over time. And I think that having a comprehensive guide that shows you how those things progress, it's going to help people think about their education differently.
Yeah.
So, just my 2 cents.
I agree.
Yeah.
Before I share some survey data with you, a birdie just texted me to tell me that you'll find when it passed the high school program guide on the What's New section of the high school.
Am I
right, Chris?
New.
Thank you. That's the birdie.
Thank you.
So you recall last meeting, somebody asked requested, I think it was a member of the board, to survey the faculty at the high school to get their read on their feelings about the weights that were that we recommended continue for AP and honors classes and the extra 5-point protocol. So here are the results. We actually collected this data today. We had 33 staff members respond to this survey. When they were asked whether they would want there to be a removal of 5 points from all grade levels for honors and AP courses taken, 76% yes, 6% said yes, they would want it removed, the 5-point add-on. They would want it removed. The other, the remaining percentage felt status quo was acceptable.
Could you repeat that, please?
That makes sense?
Repeat
that.
So,
when teachers were asked if they found the, all right, let me say this. I'm getting a little tired.
It's getting late.
When asked if they were comfortable with the proposal that we not give students 5 extra points for AP and honors, 76%, yeah, they're comfortable with that change. The remaining percentage felt the status quo, continuing to provide the extra 5 points, was acceptable. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Got that.
It is
there. So there were some comments that were provided. One person said, rip the Band-Aid off. Another said it will be difficult for the first year, but we must enact a new policy and change for the better. The students and parents can be informed of the policy change via guidance when making their schedules for the upcoming school year. But there were some other comments, which I could share later if you would like. And then the question regarding weights was posed. Should all courses be weighted equally? That includes what we call college prep, non-honors and AP. 30% said yes, all courses should be weighted equally. 70% said no, not all courses should not be weighted equally. So that just gives you a little taste, I guess, of what the 33 respondents said.
And just so we're more clear, I mean, this really is an administrative decision. You do not require, this is not a board decision, you do not need board approval to do this. This is really between you and Mr. Lasseter. You're presenting it at board meetings as a courtesy to the board, as a courtesy to the public, to invite public comment, but this isn't something that's going to come before the board as a policy or a vote.
Correct.
We did look at the one policy that would have something to do with it. It doesn't spell out those, you know, those specifics. So this really does seem to be, for the most part, a purely administrative function. So do you have a sense of a timeline, of your thinking when this will, won't happen?
Well, it would happen with the beginning of the class of 2020, the incoming freshmen, next year. That's when they would not see the extra 5 points on the, if they take an honors or AP class.
But just starting with the freshmen. So
correct.
Any current sophomores, juniors, seniors would have that going through
correct.
The rest
so
of their high school.
So if you're currently a freshman, everything still remains
still
in effect.
Still remains, okay.
So that way their transcripts aren't all of a sudden
Is the proposal to retain the current weighting that is in there? So if we remove the 5 points, we're going to keep the current weighting, or we're going to increase
the current weighting? That's what we're proposing, yes. We maintain the status quo with the weighting system.
And is
the
this
status quo?
Sorry.
With the weighting system.
Right. I think that, doesn't that put the kids at a disadvantage? I think we should be careful with that in their college applications. I think that really does. It's a double whammy, because there are other schools that have higher weighting for those.
Oh no, let me clarify. I mean by status quo that we will keep the added weight for honors and AP intact, so like other schools are doing.
I guess my question is, would we be increasing the weighting?
Not at this time.
To be more in line with others.
But your concern is that we are not in line with others, even with the existing weights.
I agree. Right.
I could bring that back to Mr. Lasseter.
Has anyone spoken to the guidance department to get their take about how we feel it would impact?
I can't say for sure, but I know Mr. Lasseter, I'm sure he has worked with them. We have one veteran guidance counselor who came to us from Monmouth County, so I know he does go to her frequently. But Rob, I'll bring that up to Mr. Lasseter. I'll just come.
I remember this whole process when it was put into place, which was about 12 years ago. And whether it's an administrative decision and not a board decision, it took, I'm going to say, a series of meetings. A long series of meetings and presentations that the board discussed and reviewed. And I don't know that there was a vote per se, but they did reach some sort of consensus to move forward with the system that's in place now. So I would be cautious.
Well,
I think that parents should have an opportunity to weigh in.
Well, here's what I was thinking. I mean, we've put together committees on lots of issues. We've put together a committee around the transgender policy. We've put together a committee around equity issues. We've put together, what do you think about the idea of putting together a committee here of administrators, guidance, parents, a board member, and do something similar? I don't think it would require a tremendous number of meetings, but even if it could have, there could be two or three meetings to kind of flesh this out before the end of the year, I think it might increase the comfort level.
Let me talk to Mr. Lasseter. Okay. I want to make sure he'd be comfortable with that as well.
Okay.
I respect his leadership and how he's been handling this. So I think first I'll ask the question that Rob is asking from the get. I'm trying to get back to the board by email on the answer. You know, is there, in fact, a consideration for changing the weights, too? I'll let you know that. And then I'll also bring up the committee, ad hoc committee idea.
Okay.
I do also want to point out that the class of 2020 will be the first class that will be required to pass the park in order to graduate. So they're going to get hit with a double whammy that year. So, I mean, I'm just pointing it out. I mean, we don't know that park will still be here. There are, you know, states are dropping like flies from the list.
Six?
We're down to six states now. In the park consortium.
And we're the only ones using it as a graduation requirement.
The class of 2020 will be the first class that has to actually pass the park in order to graduate from high school. And they will also be the first class under the new policy to not have the points added.
There's so many issues that intertwine. Other districts are even moving away from midterms and finals. And yeah. So, I mean, I think if... We're talking about lots of things as being intertwined with the strategic planning process. This seems also extremely intertwined with the strategic planning process. So, I mean, I would agree with other board members that, you know, this requires a lot of thought and consideration and discussion, and so even if we don't vote on it. Okay, so are there any other questions about the curriculum items? Because now the thing that we will do differently is we're just going to vote now. So any other discussion? No. Okay. So can I get a motion?
So moved.
No. Well, Michelle has to move all the...
Sorry. That's okay. Okay. So I would like to move...
Oh, I'm sorry. We're going to do all the committee reports?
Well, that's the agenda.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Okay.
Oh, so
we will vote at the end of all of them.
Okay.
Sorry.
So, got it.
Never mind.
Yes.
Oh, do we? Okay, I'm sorry. Sorry.
Good.
Right. See, soon. We all have to get used to our new. Very we soon. All need to get used
very
to our
soon.
New procedure.
Yeah. Very soon.
New
okay, now it's Mark.
Okay, so I want to talk briefly about finance. First, I wanted to thank Linda Hofela for her fabulous guidance for me as a new finance chair. So thank you. So we can move forward. And I have a review that she's done to help me if you have any questions. But I had two areas that I wanted to bring up. The first is we had our first finance committee meeting on the next year's budget a week ago tonight, and worked with the high school and special services, and with Linda on and Scott on the plant program to see where we stand and to start the planning process. We have another meeting a week from tonight, and we'll be doing some of the same with other groups. Per that, we're going to not move item 24 on the list. It's the last item, which talks about approving the process, because the process has started and we already talked about and decided to go forward with this process. So I'll be moving 1 through 23. There is one big item new, some small changes, but there's one big new item on the agenda, and that's items number, I believe, 18 through 20, which is the bids on the high school boiler upgrade, which came in. One of them was significantly lower than the others, and also very significantly lower than the bids that came in previously.
Yay.
And the administration is asking for our approval. It's more money than was budgeted, but we do have money to move, so that's what the context of that is going to be, is to approve the boiler upgrades, approve the movement of money into the account so we can pay the additional amount. And I've looked at those. Linda provided me with some background and some data, and I think we need to do this. We'll save money in the long run. And the boilers, when I go back 30 years and 20 years, the boilers were a source of problems then, and little has been done. So it's time to move those. So I'm speaking strongly in favor of those. Other than that, there's some small changes in some of the items, but I will be moving 1 through 23.
Thank you very much, Mark.
Thank you.
Are there any questions for Mark? I just had one. Linda, if you remember, just kind of general ballpark, the estimates that we got last year were like dramatically higher, right?
Yeah, at least $100,000 higher.
Right. So, I mean, we're moving more than we had budgeted, but it's far less. The reason we didn't move with this last year was because the estimates were just so much dramatically higher that there wasn't even enough to...
We didn't feel that we had a really competitive process because of all the other projects those bidders had already engaged in or contracted for. This year we had 10 bids come in, which is... Right. Really impressive, and we know it was a competitive process.
Right, so I just wanted to really stress that this isn't just even a one-year competitive process, this is a two-year process of really going out to bid on this to make sure we're getting the best deal on this we possibly can. Okay, wonderful. Thank you so much, Mark. And so personnel and communication, Cherise?
Sure. We had, some of them are the usual items, substitute for teachers list, different substitute positions for maternity leaves or extended hours. We unfortunately have a number of teachers who will be retiring. So we have Kathleen Murphy at Bartle School, Rachel Passachow at the Bartle School. We have Bernice Kaslavich at the Irving School, who's one of our paraprofessionals there. And Kayla Cunningham, a paraprofessional at the middle school, will be leaving in effective February 8th. I just looked at the date. And then we have one of our science teachers, Rebecca Sanders, in the high school, who is also going to be retiring. So a lot of shifting in our personnel. lot of changes to be coming at the end of the school year in terms of many positions that we'll need to be replacing very soon. So I'm sure that Scott already has plans for putting those out. We have two folks who we can congratulate for having completed their master's and master's plus 30. And in recognition of that, we are stepping them up in the based on the HPEA contract. They're eligible now for a higher pay scale. So those are under item 9. And the rest is the usual that we went over previously.
Okay, wonderful, thank you. Does anybody have any questions for Charisse?
The effective date for the resignations, is it June 30th or is it July 1st?
The Division of Pensions considers it to be July 1st because that's the first day they're not with us. Okay. Although technically they're not with us on June 30th either.
Okay.
Because their last day of school, their last day of work is usually the day after the last day of school.
Okay.
But it's really effective the end of the day, June 30th.
Okay, but that's so just a...
It's just a technicality.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, so seeing no one, we'll move on to policies and regulations. Unfortunately, Anne wasn't able to be here tonight. She is not feeling well with whatever stomach virus is sweeping through Highland Park. If you guys don't mind, I'll just run through it. It's just one policy. I'm assuming everyone's had a chance to look at it. We discussed it two meetings ago, I believe. And what we're doing is we're striking the policy review from this bylaw, which is 0131. What the board has done historically is a biennial review of every policy in our policy binder, and we've consulted with our lawyers, we've consulted with our policy, the private organization that we get does our policy research and all that. This is not a requirement.
Right.
It's busy work. So what Anne is in the process of doing is identifying all of the policies that do require either annual or biannual or biennial review, and we will do those accordingly, but we're no longer going to go through the motion of reading every policy as it comes up. So what we've done here is we've struck everything under policy review, and that's all. So does anybody have any questions about that or any comments or concerns? Okay.
Rob? No.
Anyone really excited we're not going to be doing that work for no reason?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. So. We will move on to public comment now. The Highland Park Board of Education welcomes public participation and reserve this time for your comments. Is there any public comment at this time?
There actually is. We have a student who is going to make a presentation, but I think she just stepped out.
Oh, but she should be back any second,
back.
I think.
Oh, dear. Anybody want to fill time?
I want to eat jokes.
Anybody want to do a little bamboo?
Walk really slow.
Yeah.
So I'm Chris Broadfoot. I teach at the high school. I just had a question about the survey Dr. Taylor talked about. He said 76 found it acceptable. The way I remember when I took the survey was, should we get rid of it right now? And then so I don't think 24% said it was not acceptable, but 24% said don't do it right away. 76% said do it right away. Because the earlier survey we had, only one person said not to get rid of it.
Right.
So it doesn't,
that's right.
Didn't quite make sense to me. Is that, I was just.
Thanks for the clarification. I don't have the questions here. I just have the answers. So I'm going to go on faith.
No, but that is a really important clarification because you're right. I think the first time it was all but for one unanimous that this should be changed. And so this is, should we do it now? Hence the rip the Band-Aid off now comment, or do it at the beginning of next year. And so that's the differentiation between the two. Okay.
Thank you for coming up to ask that question because my memory, I don't trust it. And I did remember that. And so, yeah, thank you.
This is why we videotape everything.
It's so smart.
It's important.
We're smart.
I'll help kill time. So in relation to that, so you mentioned that it would start with a class of 2020.
I'm sorry, did she give
Oh, yes, I'm sorry, your name and address.
Sorry, Heather Tieringer, 39 South Adelaide.
Now, can you write it and talk at the same time? That's always the... I can't.
So hard.
Okay, so you said that it would start with the class of 2020, but I mean, when students come in, even as freshmen, most of our of the courses are mixed. So, like, would you mean that, like, sophomores would get the extra points and freshmen wouldn't? Because if they're in a class together, that seems really unfair. So I think when you decide what you're going to do, if you say that you're going to implement it with the freshmen, you can't have the sophomores and up getting the points because they're sometimes in the same classes. I mean, many times in the same classes.
Right. That's a good point. Yeah.
Thank you.
It's worth considering
need a
very
committee.
Carefully.
Definitely need a committee. That's yep. complex.
I don't think it's so easy.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Any other public comment?
Hi, my name's Michelle Fan, and I'm a junior at the Highland Park High School. And do I give my address?
Yep.
Okay. Sorry.
You don't have to give. Just the street is fine.
Oh, okay. On South Fifth Avenue. And I think Amita and Mateo mentioned earlier that we had a Lunar New Year celebration, and I just wanted to talk a little bit more about that. So I guess I'll start first by explaining what the Lunar New Year is. It's a very important holiday in a lot of Asian cultures. Several Asian countries actually celebrate it, and it's really like our biggest holiday. It's kind of like Christmas and New Year's wrapped up into one, and it's a really important time for us to be spending with family, and to sort of just to be reconnecting with loved ones, relaxing, spending all of that time together, and welcoming in the new year. But a lot of students actually don't really get to do this because we spend most of our day in school. And when we come back, we're expected to have all this homework for the next day. So when our parents are working really hard in the kitchen and like making all of this food, when they're inviting friends over for dinner, and participating in these traditions that the younger generations find themselves not really being as in touch with, we don't get to really participate in much of that. So I wanted to propose that we could establish Lunar New Year as a district-wide holiday. And for every year that Lunar New Year falls on a weekday, we would be able to have that one day off for the whole school. And I know that this is kind of, I guess this is a lot to ask, but just to, I guess, give a little bit more information, New York City actually has all of their public schools had off this past Lunar New Year, and New York City is home to, I believe it's over 1,700 public schools, and about one in every six students is Asian. And here at Highland Park, about one in every five students is Asian. And I guess New York City is a little bit difficult to compare to because they're a very different school system and they're kind of a little bit farther away. But back at home in New Jersey, Edison also lets their students have off on Lunar New Year. And in Edison, I believe around 30% of the students are Asian. And they were the whole school and all of the school public schools in Edison were allowed to have off. So that's about 19 schools, I believe, and all of their students were able to take the day off. And in Highland Park, I believe we have a lot of, we have a few Jewish holidays where we take off, and we also have 30% of our population is Jewish. So like just to give a few statistics and put all of this into perspective. And being that one in every five students at the Highland Park High School is Asian, I think that we kind of deserve to have our own holiday too, that we can take off. So.
Thank you.
Could I comment on
that,
please?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, sure. Any questions?
Yeah, well, so Michelle, my son-in-law is Chinese American, mm-hmm. and so my grandkids have two heritages and to celebrate.
Yeah.
And I've been with them and family and his sister who lives in Edison and their kids at the Lunar New Year celebrations. and gone from restaurant to restaurant and given the dragons money in the red envelopes and all of that. And it's a great holiday, and it's a great time for family. So personally, at least, I'm very sympathetic. I mean, my grandkids had off Monday. They live in New York. Mm-hmm. Their cousins live in Edison. They had off. So I think it's definitely something worth considering.
Yeah.
And just thank you. Thank you for coming forward with it.
No problem. Just to add a little bit more onto that, actually, you just reminded me. This Lunar New Year event that we held, I was able to talk to a lot of students because we were organizing this whole event. And I talked to a lot of students, and they brought up how nowadays they don't really get to, they're not really as in touch with their culture as they would like to be. So for Lunar New Year, New York City had a whole bunch of museums open for free that one day so that the students could celebrate and go and learn a little bit more about their own heritage. But being that our students here are expected to go to school on that day, a lot of us don't get to learn about something or about a country that our parents had to leave behind, about a culture that seems to be just sort of overlooked from time to time. And it really matters to me personally because I come from an immigrant family, and we've like adjusted to life in America. Like, it's not really difficult for me because I got here when I was pretty young, but like seeing my parents keeping their culture alive is really important. And I want to be part of that. And I feel like a really important aspect of that is being able to take that day off and spend it with your family and learn about all of the stories that they have to tell you.
Thank you so much, Michelle. I really appreciate you bringing this forward to the administration and for coming to the board. And I'm just watching your mom watch you is making me choke up. And I think it's a wonderful proposal, and I think all of your points are very well taken, and we will be sure to come to a decision really quickly for you. Thank you.
Do we have extra days built into our calendar above and beyond what are required by the state?
We do. We have, in our contract, we have 182 days.
Right.
Which we try to maintain every year. I mean, I wouldn't want to take it from that. I mean, I like that we have 182 days. We, you know, start a day earlier, or we'd go a day later, you know.
I'm sorry, but what?
We use the days for professional development, for instance.
Got it.
Now, keep in mind that this isn't a decision we don't have to make this year, necessarily. Mm-hmm.
But this year it falls on a Saturday.
So, we've got some time to think about it.
Okay.
Or for next year. Yeah, okay. Well, 2016. Right.
Correct. This time next year we'll be discussing it.
Wednesday. All right. So pressure's on for 2017.
Which should be a nice day to have a hump of the week, you know, the middle of the week, right?
No, but I mean, I think it's something we should consider and just come to a decision on, you know, now. I mean, you know, I think, you know, Michelle's brought this to us, and it's certainly something that, you know, I'd like to decide before 2017, personally.
I agree. Yeah.
Even if we don't have to plan for it now. I mean,
I also want to just take a little moment to say that I was, you know, on a personal level, like, so proud of you, Michelle, for getting up and speaking, and for the letter that you sent us. It was well researched. You had, you know, footnotes with all kinds of information. You taught us a lot. So I think, you know, your parents are obviously proud, and your teacher should be proud. But, you know, as a board member sitting here, I'm thinking this is amazing. You know, not many adults will come to the board with a proposal like this. So, thank you.
Making everybody plots. Okay, is there any other public comment?
Yes, one more thing really quick. I just got a text from a student with a question. This is kind of something we went over before, but.
So I think we would have to like have the, how do we do that? Do we have?
Can I just ask the question by proxy,
yeah,
I guess?
That's so cool.
But do we have to state their name and their?
I mean,
yeah, it was already asked.
Yeah.
Yeah, so never mind.
What?
But that's
I'm
a good
lost.
Question.
Oh, is it built into the calendar?
Sure.
It might be easier for you to text somebody else in the audience and have that person actually come back for public comment. Would that work?
I'm so confused. What just happened? No idea what just happened.
So,
Okay, go ahead.
But that kind of raises an interesting point, you know, like live questions from home or something.
Yeah, I
agree with
that. I like it. She would ask it as her own question.
Yeah, she could.
You could go up to the podium and ask the question.
Okay. Asked and answered. No, no.
Well, I think we've just witnessed a desire for a different type of interaction from our youth contingent.
It was really interesting. It was, you know, kind of one of those Twitter conversations, like live. So if students have questions, they, you know, tweet to their student reps, like live.
Right, right.
That's great.
We'll talk about it next meeting.
So my name is Kim Hammond. I'm at Harrison Avenue here in Highland Park. I was actually going to wait for the second comment. Being a veteran board meeting come attendee, I was going to wait. But then I thought if I came up now, you'll probably have no one at your second comment section. So I'm actually here on behalf of the Highland Park Boosters. We have a fundraising event coming up on March 4th, which is called Designer Bag Bingo. It's going to be held at the Senior Youth Center. The doors open at 6:30, and I'm inviting all of you to attend. We've actually had a really fantastic response. The school's been wonderful about sending out our notices via the paperless, and we really are having a fabulous response to this event. But I thought it'd be a nice opportunity to just, I sort of picked the wrong night in one respect, because of length, but it's actually a great night to come and talk about sort of the importance of these different curricular activities in the lives of our students. A lot of the kids that you saw here tonight received sports award. They also received a DEC award. If there were music awards, a lot of those same kids would have been coming up for a music award. The interesting thing about our sports teams is that we actually have, between our middle school and our high school, we have 34 sports teams. And 160 sporting events take place here every year. That's how many visiting schools come to us between our middle school and our high school. So I think for a really small place, that's a really big program. And one thing that I have observed on our fields and courses is something I haven't observed personally at a lot of other events. It's a place where we have this really diverse cross-section of our student body. I would say probably more socioeconomically and racially diverse than in other areas. And I think that probably happens because in a lot of things kids do, they might choose to do things with friends they already have. But if you love to play baseball, you play baseball regardless of who else is going to be on that team. And it really allows those students to go outside of their usual circle and their usual social circle and academic circle, and really sort of bond with kids they might not otherwise know. So the Booster Club is really just a way to kind of support. There's sort of a three-pronged type of thing. It's like the typical fundraising, which is primarily the function of a Booster Club. I had more remarks. I'm just going to sort of quickly hit just a few points. But fundraising, which is obvious and typical thing that do. But also here, we're really trying to promote our sporting events. So if you go to a football game or a basketball game, our bleachers are not very full. We have more people coming to our games as for our visiting team than we do for our home teams. Part of that is like how winning some of our different teams are, and part of that is a reflection of how small we are. So part of what we do is really sort of just even getting the word out that there's a sporting event going on and really inviting people to come. But I see this interesting cross-section of where these students intersect as a really unique opportunity for our broader community to connect. And so that's sort of another focus that the Booster Club is hoping to promote. And the value of an organization and not sort of just, you know, me coming. I know I was at, I've become the snack shack lady. And Dr. Taylor had even remarked that he was quite surprised to see me selling burgers at snack shack. I don't have kids that play football. My kids do soccer and wrestling. But the idea is that, you know, you sort of cross these sports. It's not that I just worry about what my kids are doing. I want to worry as an athletic department how we're supporting all of our different students. And the value of the organization is sort of that you become like a memory keeper and a legacy can build, so over time. And the idea is really, it's all about, you know, for me it comes down to this idea of self-esteem. And the kids that are participating are really valuing what they're doing. And part of that happens by realizing that their broader community really values and observes what they do, and there's an audience for that. So I cut my remarks shorter, believe it or not. I'd love to, further conversation or provide information or answer questions when it's not such a late hour. But to that end, I really encourage people to come out to this event. It's going to be a real fun, low-cost way to sort of spread the joy and let our students know that we care about what they're doing. So thank you.
Thanks, Kim. Can I ask you a quick question? Are you guys meeting on a regular basis? Like, how are you structuring yourself?
Oh, yeah, that's a great question. So we have just formed, this is new, as a 501c3, which is great. It allows people that want to make, well, any size contribution, but especially larger contributions would be tax-free. We have a board of trustees of 11 people from the community. And we just had a public meeting that was advertised through our paperless system last Wednesday. The idea is to sort of not be meeting heavy, and we're trying to, we have our own web, we have a website, it's linked to the school website, to try to build sort of an avenue of communication that way. But we'll have like one meeting per semester.
Well, my thought was, one of the things that we're trying to do as a board is really have the board, doing a lot of outreach to all of the different organizations in town. So, maybe you and I should discuss whether you would like a board liaison, having a board member come and attend your meetings, and then come back and report back to the board as a regular.
That would be fabulous.
Okay.
Very well.
Wonderful.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
I actually have one question. Is this just for parents who want to get more people to attend the sporting events, or are students also allowed to come to these meetings?
I would say meetings are open to anyone who wants to attend. The idea of the meetings usually is, we're just doing an agenda about, following up on sort of our to-dos, upcoming fundraising, and then at the end it's always comments, ideas, ways to sort of grow the ideas that we're working on. So. Students would definitely be open. And it's really not just for parents of kids who are already participating in sports. There might be another relative, or it might be someone who actually doesn't have kids that do sports but was a huge, sport player or just loves sports. So, we'll take anybody.
Thank you, Kim. Is there any other public comment? Okay, seeing none, we will actually go back to where we will vote. So, hold on. Okay, so Michelle, can you give us the curriculum and can you move the curriculum and instruction items?
Yes, I would like to move items 1 through 11, please.
Okay, is there any discussion? Any discussion on the curriculum items? Oh, sorry, is there a second?
Second.
Now, is there any discussion? Okay. Seeing none, Linda, can we have a roll call?
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Simarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden DiNicola?
Yes.
Ms. Pietrobono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
Okay, Mark, can we have the, can you move the finance and facilities?
Yes, I'm going to move items 1 through 23.
And we're striking 24, right?
Striking 24.
Excellent. Can I have
a second?
Can I get a second?
Second. Sorry.
Is there any discussion on the finance and facilities items? Okay, Linda?
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Simarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden DiNicola?
Yes.
Ms. Pietrobono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
And Charisse, can you move the personnel and communications items?
Sure, I'm going to move items 1 through 11 on the personnel and communications.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Linda? I'm sorry, any discussion?
No.
Okay, seeing none, Linda?
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Simarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden DiNicola?
Yes.
Ms. Pietrobono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
Okay, and I guess I will move the policy and regulations. There's just one item to move. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Okay, seeing none, Linda?
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Simarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden-Nicola?
Yes.
Ms. Pietrobono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
Okay, so that brings us to my president's report. I don't have anything specific prepared for this evening, but I did want to just kind of update on the three items that I've presented on at our last couple of board meetings, the first one being our board structure. I kind of alluded to the fact that we talk about this a little bit more. We have...
good night, guys. Thank you so much.
Good night.
One of the things that Scott and I have looked at as we've started to flesh out this new structure for the board meetings is the space in between board meetings, which doesn't really work. When you want to have one board meeting to do the workshop and have all the discussion, and then you want to vote, you don't want a lot of time in between the two to have a bunch of other things come up. If you've taken a look at the new board calendar that we've proposed that's on the agenda, we've kind of squished those meetings together so that we only have a week now in between our workshop sessions and our voting sessions, which I think makes a lot more sense. And then that also, in between time, will give more chances for committee meetings. I don't know if anybody in the public has noticed, we've stopped doing the personnel committee did not meet this evening, because we're not doing those meetings right before. The idea is we're taking more time in between meetings and with the workshop meetings to really flesh out items rather than meeting hurriedly for half an hour before closed session and then coming out here and then voting on things we haven't really thought much about. So we'll be taking a look at that later. I guess that's under, where do we have that?
Letter E.
It is. It's under old business.
Yes.
So we'll talk about that more under old business as well. And then the other thing that I wanted to put out to the board is kind of a little bit what I was talking about with Kim, how we report out on the liaison positions. So in kind of my work on doing some of the HaTikva outreach that I've done over the last month or so, I've gotten to see a couple of other boards and how they function, and that's always really, I'm a dork, it's really exciting. I like to see how they structure things and kind of take some best practices away. And one of the things that I saw when I went to the South River board meeting is that's just a function of how they do their reporting out. They report out their committees, and then they report all the liaisons report out. So with the board's permission, I would like for us to start doing that so that as we all attend our respective liaison meetings, those will then be on each agenda. So if there hasn't been a meeting, then you've got nothing to report. If there has been a meeting, then you'll report out to the board what happened at your meeting. And then that's just a way to keep communication flowing in so many different areas in town. So does anybody have any thoughts about that?
How will those get onto the agenda?
It will just automatically be on the agenda.
It'll be just
you won't have to say, oh, I went to a meeting, it's on the agenda. They'll just be listed on the agenda as a matter of course. Is my
time for your updates? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Well,
are you going to have each committee listed and then each liaison committee listed, or are you going to just have
just like a liaison report will be listed
after each of the standing committees?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yep.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. And then there isn't anything. There isn't a lot to report on the HaTikva situation, although I did just find out on Friday that after Scott and I had a meeting, 2 weeks ago now, at the Department of Education with the president of the State Board of Education and the director of the Office of Charter Schools, which, and then also it was the superintendent from East Brunswick was in attendance, and the business administrator from East Brunswick. And it was a really productive, it was a very productive meeting. I think probably the most interesting part for me was watching the president of the State Board of Education look at the director of the Office of Charter Schools and basically say, so how does this happen? How does a charter school that is only supposed to have students from one district have students from 28 districts? And there wasn't really a response that that really had anything to do with what's going on here. So, you know, I think we have a very strong position here, and we have the Department of Ed really kind of scratching their heads as to how this has happened and why this has happened. And I think it really strengthens our position in terms of opposing this latest expansion request, which would just continue to add to that burden. And then as a follow-up to that meeting, I think the president of the state boards you know, his kind of personal views on charters were that they're very good things and that they help kids in urban districts, and he really believes in school choice, but he's kind of not trying to figure out why you would need a charter school in East Brunswick. So he actually asked if he could come to East Brunswick to see the district for himself. So he's actually coming back a week from today on Monday morning. Scott and I will go to East Brunswick, and we were kind of like, really, you want to come talk to us more? Okay, sure. So
that's great.
So that's been scheduled for Monday morning, and he's also opened that up to other districts. So we'll invite, you know, some of the folks that we've been talking to in Edison and North Brunswick and South River and all these other places that are also being heavily impacted by Hatikva. So I look forward to being able to update you some more by the next meeting. And by the next meeting, we will most likely have the decision from the Department of Education as to whether they get this expansion, whether this expansion request is approved. That decision is expected end of February, beginning of March. So we should know by our next meeting.
Darcy, excuse me, is the petition still able to be signed?
Yep, the petition is still up. The Highland Park plan, it actually has a nice piece up right now that deals, you know, kind of with budget issues, Hatikva issues, kind of rolled it all up into one. I think the petition was linked there. Yeah. So that is definitely still going. And then the other issue that we'll talk a little bit more as we get into old business is the two resolutions that are there. And we talked last time a lot about the graduation requirements. And I've worked with folks at the Education Law Center to flesh that out into a resolution. So I'm presenting two resolutions to the board tonight. One that is the resolution that we'll adopt that I will, you know, spread out to other districts. I've actually already shared it with some other board members. I've shared it with the board president at Hopewell Valley, which is my alma mater, which kind of makes me... I was kind of excited about that, and that it's actually the resolution with a couple of tweaks is actually on their agenda for tonight as well. So the resolution is already getting out there, and I think it's really important to raise awareness. As Cherie said earlier, you know, the class of 2020, it's so hard to really say that, will be the first one that PARC becomes, you have to pass PARC. And not only do you have to pass PARC, you have to take every PARC to even be considered for graduation. So the Department of Education is really upping the stakes on this particular test, as the rest of the country seems to be throwing it out the window. So it's kind of a fascinating, fascinating time.
Indeed.
So I'm really glad that our board can kind of be at the, you know, kind of be on the forefront of this and, you know, educating other boards. And to that effect, I've also drawn up a resolution that will go to the Delegate Assembly. So if we approve that tonight, then we will submit that to the New Jersey School Boards Association. It'll first be reviewed by the Resolution Subcommittee, and then should we get through the Resolution Subcommittee, it'll be presented to boards across the state for approval for the Delegate Assembly, and then it becomes New Jersey School Boards Association policy. So, you know, this is the way we can implement change in a system that is going in one direction when we want to go in that direction. This is how you kind of try to steer the ship back this way. So, so with that, why don't we move on to old business? We had on there for the first item, the High School Honors AP Weighting System. I think we've covered that one. And then the next two are those resolutions. Did anyone have any questions, concerns, thoughts about the resolutions?
Just thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Those are my only thoughts.
Those were your only thoughts.
Okay, yeah, so great. Good stuff.
Oh, and then we also have, I'm sorry, we also have the resolution of the state funding of the pension shortfall. Did everybody get a chance to take a look at that one? It's on the drive, and then I had also sent it out separately. I think about a week or so ago, I sent it out in a separate email.
I'll have to check it out.
I mean, if folks aren't comfortable with it, we can table that one for now. That one's not as... the graduation requirement one now has a bit of urgency to it because in order for me to submit it to the New Jersey School Boards Association, we have to do it tonight. But do people want to, if folks haven't had a chance to take a look at that one, do we want to be able to table that one for tonight?
Well, let's take a look.
Well, this is the graduation requirements one. I don't know that the TPAF one we passed out at the last meeting. Why don't we do that? I'm kind of getting a lot of quizzical looks on that one, so why don't we?
It was just that it was a while ago. I think it's maybe just not fresh in the memory.
Yeah, right, that's right.
Well, we didn't really discuss it all that much last week because Linda had just presented it to us, so we hadn't really had a chance to take a look at it. But basically, the gist of it is that one of the considerations that are out there because of the whole pension crisis is that the state will push those expenses down to the districts. And this is saying, oh, no. That's not going to do.
Yes.
Yeah, it's. I think it's a very good resolution, and okay. That resolution and similar resolutions are kind of, you know, have started to circulate. So, I mean, I'm very comfortable with the resolution, but okay, if folks,
I think it was just buried in the memory.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So with that refresher, you're okay.
Totally
so we have
good.
Okay.
Totally good.
So there no questions, no.
No.
Okay. Okay. So do I guess I have to move them individually, Linda? Okay. So first, I will move the resolution of the state funding of the pension shortfall. Do I need to do anything other than that? Nope. Okay, can I get a second?
Second.
Lots of seconds.
Lots of seconds.
Linda, roll call.
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Cimarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McGatta Di Nicola?
Yes.
Ms. Pietrobono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
Okay, and then the second one is the resolution of the Highland Park Board of Education graduation requirements policy, language for the New Jersey School Boards Association Delegate Assembly. Did anybody have any questions, specific questions to that one?
Second,
wonderful. I'm sorry, any specific questions to that one? I love asking for questions. I just want everyone's input. Okay, so, Linda?
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Cimarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden Di Nicola?
Yes.
Ms. Pietrobono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Affirmative.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
Just making sure you're awake. Okay, and then the last one. I'm going to make one quick change on the fly to the wording that's in the agenda. It's the resolution of the Highland Park Board of Education graduation requirements regulations, not legislation. Right. But it's in the agenda. The change was made to the resolution itself, but the change was not made on the agenda. Is there a second?
Second.
Mark, you're good. Is there any discussion on that one? Okay, Linda.
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Cimarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden Di Nicola?
Yes.
Ms. Pietrobono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
Okay, and then the last item under old business is that Board of Education meeting calendar that I brought up in my president's report, where we'll move those workshop meetings closer to our voting meetings. Voting meetings will stay the same, and we'll still have all the same recognitions. We're still gonna move from school to school. Like, I think this was so successful tonight. This was so wonderful. It was so nice to see the kids and their parents in a packed house for, for such a positive event. I was thrilled to see that. So I really look forward to all of these board meetings that are coming up this year. So I would like to move the Board of Education meeting calendar. Can I get a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Okay, seeing none, Linda?
Ms. Beyer?
Yes.
Ms. Cimarusti?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Magaziner?
Yes.
Ms. McFadden Di Nicola?
Yes.
Ms. Pietrobono?
Yes.
Ms. Richardson?
Yes.
Mr. Roslowitz?
Yes.
Okay, so now we're going to move on to new business, and we have one item on there that I believe, Scott, you're going to discuss, the Strauss Esme online access.
We currently use Strauss Esme to help us keep on top of the latest changes in policy. There's another service, a product I should say, it provides that I've used in several other districts that would allow us to put all of our policies online and have access to a search engine that Strauss Esme puts out. And you could essentially, if you have access to this web-based tool, you can punch in a keyword like discipline, and all of our policies on discipline would come up, and you click download or print. If this is something the board is interested in doing at some point, you have in front of you the contract, which identify the costs for doing this. It wouldn't be, you know, it wouldn't be inexpensive, but then again, it's not a break the banker. You're talking about a startup fee of close to $1,000, which is a one-time fee. And then if we were to just want access for board members to help facilitate policy revision and whatnot, I think the cost is about $1,600 a year. And the additional cost, if we open it up to the public so that there would be a portal on our website, you click, it takes it all our policies, search engine and all, it's close to another $400. So total, you're looking at about a $2,000 annual fee we would pay for that service. I want to get the board's input. Is there interest in doing this?
Could you talk a little bit about, a little more about your experience with, I mean, I don't want to keep you here too much longer, but what you see as the benefit? You've seen this in action compared to what we have now, which really what we have now is not terribly searchable. It's, the policies are there, but it's kind of incumbent upon the user to kind of have somewhat of a sense of familiarity with the policies.
Sure. So for a member of the board or an administrator, whoever has access to this engine, if you have a quick question about a policy, a parent calls, or you're about to do something that you're concerned might contradict policy, you can go on the web using this tool, throw in a search keyword for a search, and find all that information, as opposed to going into the hard copies, which could take a lot of time, especially if you you want language around a specific topic, which could cross over into different policies and different regulations. It just made things very efficient and very clear. I remember having one incident in which it was a suspension issue in my last district, and the high school principal called me, said, "Dr. Taylor, how should I handle this particular case?" I didn't know what the board policy had to say about this particular concern regarding suspension. It was like, that was actually a question about suspension versus expulsion. So I was able to quickly go into the search engine, give him an answer on the fly, and he was able to get back to the parent in a very timely fashion. It could have taken more time, and that also might have delayed the parent's agita, you know, and just exacerbated the situation. I had not used this as far as going to the public. So that would be pioneering for me if we did it here. So that's that I can't speak about.
Okay. My first thought is, in the last few years that I've been doing board work, I've seen any number of ways of revising policy that's not terribly successful. Have you found this to be a successful way in terms of revision of policy? Where would...
Not any more successful than it would be the way we're doing it now. It was more about just having quick, easy access if you needed answers on the spot.
Right. But for board members, I mean, right now, very often it takes a very long time to get them changes actually loaded to the website. And we were, like last year, we were given binders that, I kid you not, two of them that are this thick, which must have taken, Susan, I shudder to think how many hours she spent compiling that to give that to us, and the printing and the this and the that. So I'm thinking I would assume that it would save, you know, administrative.
It could save time on our end a little bit. Yeah, the housekeeping, that's a good point. The housekeeping piece of it would be good. You know, conceivably, Susan would say to members of the board looking at a specific policy, please go here, pull it down, or here's a PDF, I can email you quickly. Whereas now she has to scan documents and send
right.
it.
Right.
And also she can call that information very quickly just by searching on the web using Strauss Esme's tool. There's a point to that, too.
Scott, do we have any of our policy documents online at this time?
Mm-hmm.
They are, okay.
It's all there. It's just, it's relatively clumsy. I've tried searching. It's not terribly successful in a search.
I see. Okay.
I think the search feature used to be a lot better before the transition to the new website. Mm-hmm. And I think our discussion was that as our website gets fleshed out, that the search feature is supposed to be improved as our website moves forward. because right now we just, I forget what the conversation was, it just pulled all the old documents and ported them in, so right. Some of the searching ability is not there. But would Strauss-Esme be holding our current policy?
Yes. Yeah, and so the startup fee has them taking all of our work, putting it into their database, and then they'd be responsible for updating that database whenever we make a policy change. So Susan would take whatever we do, send it off, and then they would take care of it from there. I mean, in the name of transparency, you are doing, you're moving forward a step by giving, if you go the public portal route, much more access to us and what we are about.
You know, if there's some way that we're able to quantify what the efficiencies that we may be able to achieve, or but in terms of time and in terms of the cost of copying and paper, and you know, it may be that may be something that, you know, turns out not to be an actual cost. But we need, I think we need to weigh that with the idea of spending, and even an additional $2,000 doesn't seem like a lot of money, but I think in a time of a very tight budget, I think that we need to figure out whether it's it may be a win. So if we can come up with something that would actually help us to understand, you know, how much more efficient we would be operating, maybe that would help us to push it through.
I mean, I think that there are definitely a couple of different areas. I mean, you bring up a good point about communication and our desire to have our public have more, the public, HP public, have more access to what it is we're doing as a board and be able to engage with that information. Right now it is, unless you know that each of the sort of groupings of zeros, thousands, 2,000s, 3,000s relate to a specific area, you don't know where to begin to
look
for.
It's not terribly user-friendly.
A specific policy, right? We're not talking about something as exact as the Dewey Decimal System, though. You know, which back in its day was wonderful. So we have, there's that piece with the, you know, making it more publicly available. But I think we also, if you were able to look at, and I think this is what Rob is talking about specifically, how this plays out in terms of how much time savings this provides in the central office, mm-hmm. in terms of manpower that can be spent doing other things that we would then not have to perhaps be sending someplace else. I don't know if that's something that you can kind of take a look at in terms of.
I can ask Susan, who does a lot of that legwork, to try. Okay. She can give us a ballpark.
Right.
I'll prepare that for the next meeting.
Great. Does anybody have any other comments about that one? Okay. Any other new business?
I had a few things. Wanted to remind people of some events. First off, the chili cook-off is something that was sent out through the paper list, and that's March 5th, 5:30. And that benefits the middle school Hershey Park festival trip.
And it's
so fun.
They go
on every year. And I think it's the biggest trip that the middle school holds. And so they do a lot of fundraising around that. So I wanted to remind people of that. That's, again, Saturday, March 5th, 5:30 to 8. And then right after that, on the same day, is the Buddy Ball Talent Showcase. That's at 7 p.m. And Buddy Ball is a program that my kids participated in. It was really wonderful. It's pretty much the only time they ever spent playing basketball their entire lives. But they loved it. And they have little trophies, and they're very proud of them. So it's a really great program. And it buddies up teenage volunteer pals with younger buddies who introduce them to the sport. They do kind of, you know, training drills. But it's really centered around fun, associating fun with sports. Not many kids get to do that because, you know, not every family is invested in sports
programs. So I think for some of us, it's the only time that they do get to do that. And that is at 7 p.m. March 5th. The other thing that was brought to my attention was difficulty for parents to get their children from after school, the after school program, to activities inside town that are offered for children. Like, for example, the Girls on the Run program is held at the middle school track. And it's for girls, I believe, from ages 8 to 11, grades 3 to 5, I believe. So they're not able to get from the after school program or Bartle School in general over to the program that begins at, I think it begins at 4:30. So a couple of the parents did ask me to bring this up at the board table to see if there was some sort of coordination that we could kind of kick off some conversation about coordinating the after school program with a walking school bus type event that would have volunteers, parent volunteers, or maybe even, you know, seniors, like high school seniors that are headed over in the same direction, because there are several different activities. Like the Girls on the Run program is just one. So many of the parents that have the inability to take their children from school to these programs, their children miss out, and it's simply because their parents work and they can't get them to these programs. And it's unfortunate because we're a walking town. So it would only require a little bit of coordination. And so I was wondering if that could be something that we could bring to the attention of administration or the after school program to see if there was some sort of conversation we could start about that. It's something that was brought to my attention.
Definitely something I can explore.
Okay.
Yeah.
I know you have committees just, you know.
I'm trying to think of what, who and how to get that moving.
Yeah, I think that, you know, it would be a conversation in the beginning. It would be maybe something like a survey, a parent survey, to see if that was something that they would want to volunteer for, if they have activities that they know of that we are not aware of in town. But it would require some coordinating. And I would think that it would have to kind of begin, it would coalesce at least around the school, because that's where the kids are coming from. And again, this is only for students that are not old enough to walk on their own. So it would be generally, I would think, like third to fifth grade. So I don't know that it would be that big a project, but it seems a little daunting, you know?
It does. Do you know if there are any high school students volunteering with the Girls on the Run program?
They have.
Doing volunteer hours?
I don't know if there's any high school students. I don't know that for sure. But I do know for sure that there is, I think it's a sorority, a college sorority, I think at Rutgers, that volunteers time with the Girls on the Run program.
Because one of the thoughts that I'm having as you're saying this is there are students who need to get volunteer hours.
Right.
You know, perhaps there is some way for us to build this as a volunteer opportunity to work with the Girls on the Run program and be the walking school bus.
Yeah, and like I said, this is one of
Bartle School up to the middle school track.
Yeah, and generally it does seem to be that direction, like Bartle to this area here, the middle school, high school. Yeah. The other program that I heard of was the theater program that kids were not able to attend because they were, you know, in the after school program without transportation.
Yeah. I mean, can't we just go straight to the after school program and see if they think there's some way that they could coordinate, you know?
We could. The problem we're having, and this is actually what was brought up at one of my community advisory committees, is that we don't really have a central point person for the aftercare program right now, a supervisor. Oh. I mean, Susan Adato is really, she takes care of the books. Then you've got building people like Linda Moran. So once I could figure out who that point person would be, that's
probably
somebody
Linda.
Who could work.
Sounds like probably Linda. I mean, it would be
Linda Moran,
because it would be mostly kids coming from Bartle going to other locations. Mm. I mean, don't we sometimes have students that work with the after school programs?
I'm not sure.
I think I remember seeing, you know, approvals on agendas of students working with the after school program. Yeah.
They work with the kids.
Right. But I mean, it might be conceivable to have an extra, you know, one for a few hours, a couple days a week or something to, you know, do that walking or something.
You know.
Michelle, I might follow up with you personally about this.
Okay.
To get more input.
Yeah, great. It was something that was brought to my attention by after school parents. And I, you know, not being an after-school parent myself, I did not put two and two together, not realizing that it was so difficult. So I volunteered myself, actually, to be a driving school bus from Bartle. My minivan can fit five kids, but, you know, there's probably more than five kids that would like to participate in these activities. And they're kind of, you know, unfortunately stuck in the aftercare program, so.
Not that the aftercare program isn't lovely.
Not that there's anything wrong with that.
Okay, is there any other new business?
There was one other thing I wanted to say. No, go ahead, Charisse.
So Sunday, February 28th is the next Latino Parent Night at the HP Middle School. Principal Azumwe is running that program. I think it's at, I want to say it's at 6 p.m., but I'm not entirely sure now. But it is going to be February 28th, and I know that they did send out some communications already. The other thing is just to make you aware, and I had briefly discussed, Strauss Esme will be dropping Alert 208, which is a set of policies that will need to be reviewed on February 26th. So for the next agenda, we will need to probably bring those up for first reading.
Great, thank you. Michelle, you had something?
Oh, no. So being that this is February and it is Black History Month, it brought to my attention that we, being the chair of the curriculum committee, don't have a complete, I would say, curriculum, I guess, in terms of American history. So I wanted to see if we could talk more about including African American history in our curriculum year round rather than just in the month of February. So I think I wanted to bring that up in new business just to see if we could begin the discussion again. It's another big discussion.
Michelle and I actually talked about this briefly, and I suggested we sick our supervisor of curriculum and instruction for humanities on that project.
Right.
And first I would want her or him to audit.
Welcome.
I'm delegating.
Right.
That's one of the jobs I have. So I'm going to probably have that person take care of that. First, I'd like that individual to audit current curriculum to see what we do.
Right.
And maybe work from there.
There is a mandate from the state of New Jersey Department of Education that cultural learning that represents all cultures living in a district be represented within the curriculum. And that's straight from the DOE. So thank you. We also have the Highland Park African American History Project. Highland Park, parents of students of color, together with the HP Historical Society, and however it works out with the folks who are in all of our humanities areas, we'll have some discussions over time on how that might flesh out, but we actually have someone who is going to be starting to collect histories of local people as a way of exploring local history, New Jersey history, and how it sort of fits in with history of time at the time they were here. So a little bit that will be worked on by the district over time.
Excellent. Yep. Rob, you have something?
Yep. A lot, but I'm holding it in. I'm holding it in.
Okay. You sure?
Save it for the next time.
Okay. You sure? We're here.
Okay.
All right. Is there any other new business? Okay. So seeing none, I think we are going to end our first voting session on the road. I just want to say how excited I am that this
public comment.
Oh, sorry. One more public comment. Oh my gosh. I'm so sorry. What is it with me? The public comment tonight. Public comment. The Highland Park Board of Education welcomes public participation and has reserved this time for your comments. Is there any more public comment? Okay. I think everybody's pretty much toast at this point. Okay, seeing none, we will adjourn the first voting session on the road. And I want to thank Mr. Lassiter for hosting us here and for all the students and families that came out. It was so wonderful to see everyone. I look forward to the next one. Our next one's at the middle school, right? Our next recognition is at the middle school, right? So we kind of go down the line age-wise. So can I get a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everybody.